Welcome to Analysis Roulette. I'm Dia. I use they, them pronouns.
Hi, everyone. I'm Duck. I use he, they pronouns.
And this week, we are diving into a postmodern analysis of My Hero Academia, or Boku no Hero Academia, depending on which language you prefer your anime titles in.
This is going to be interesting, because I've done very little preparatory work, because Dia told me that they had a plan that involved watching too many episodes.
Yeah, so I did learn from the Yu-Gi-Oh! Situation.
But I do appreciate that. You have learned my weaknesses and limitations.
And basically, I would have asked you to watch the first couple of episodes, but since you already have, I figured you do not need to subject yourself to watching loop anime.
That's fair. I have watched the first few episodes.
This is going to be a slightly broader look. Usually we take a specific chunk of whatever the thing is and go into that. But because this is a very structural school of criticism, I found this virtually impossible to do coherently. So what we're going to do instead is I'm going to jump around and I'm just going to catch you up on context you require.
Sounds good. I'm here for story time.
Yes. So, usually one of us explains each thing. Do you want to give me like a baseline, your understanding of what My Hero Academia is?
In a world where everyone is superheroes, some people are not superheroes. So our protagonist finds like a sideways way to become extra super because he's very sad and bullied about not being super. And then the superhero school. At about the point of the entrance exam into the superhero school, I stopped watching because there was a bit of body horror that I found a little bit off-putting.
So a thing you will not have found out from watching the first four or five episodes, I assume you went anime rather than manga.
I did go anime, yeah.
Yeah. From watching the first four or five episodes, a thing you may not have picked up on is how much nothing in that summary comes up again.
Oh, fantastic. I'm just ignorant of what this anime is really like.
No, that is the experience of watching this anime. You have accurately described the experience of watching this for the first time.
All these things are set up, and then...
The thing is, it's not that there isn't a coherent and genuinely well-written and good plot. I do not mean this as a dunk on My Hero Academia. I actually think it's very well-written, with areas that are to my taste and not to my taste, but it is, like, coherently put together.
Right, just not necessarily However, along the lines that are originally set up.
It is not set up like a linear narrative, which is fair, because it's not one. But it can make it a very weird viewing experience if you go in watching kind of a shonen anime that you're kind of expecting to be, like, you know... narrative.
If you thought that point B was going to relate to point A, which I had assumed, I'm excited to learn in what ways I am wrong.
It's very much like, you know, when you learn about poetry in like primary school and they tell you this is what rhyming means and this is what like a rhyme scheme is. It might be ABAB or it might be AABB, and they don't go into any more depth. And then you do GCSE and like maybe they go, well, this one is AABB in the first verse but ABAB in the second verse.
And then you get online and you're like, oh, poetry is just where you put line breaks in.
Yeah. And then sometimes you go to university and study Medieval Norse and you learn about alliterative verse and you want to cry.
I frequently have experience.
My Hero Academia is the alliterative verse of rhyme schemes.
I can't.
There is something happening, but it's not what you are expecting from the setup you are given in the opening line.
Yeah. A challenge for us in the future, by the way, is to identify the sestina of anime.
Sorry, you got me right as I was taking a sip of water.
Like, something extremely highly structured, very deliberate repetition and callbacks.
Oh, you are going to love it when I make you watch Detective Conan. What if there was a sestina composed entirely of small houses of cards that could collapse at any moment? And also it was Sherlock Holmes fanfiction.
See, I was excited, and then you said it was Sherlock Holmes, and I lost my interest.
I cannot express to you how much Sherlock Holmes would have been improved if Sherlock Holmes had been a middle school detective trying to get back into his adult body.
That does sound funny.
It's incredible. It is my favourite anime. Anyway, we're not getting to the point right now, but this is sort of where I'm going with this. So yes, thank you for your summary of My Hero Academia. We're now going to get to my summary
all the ways
of
which
My Hero
I am
Academia.
Not necessarily wrong, but stopping too early.
So, when you embark into My Hero Academia, you're taken into a future where almost everybody has a quirk, which is a superpower. It's very, like, familiar superhero setup. You know, everybody has their own power. People who have particularly strong powers become pro-heroes or superheroes. This is explicitly in text said to be based on old comic books.
Right. There's a character who's literally just dressing up as, like, copyright non-infringing Captain America.
Yeah. Except significantly more terrifying. We're not going to get into my beef with some of the character designs. That's not relevant to my analysis. I just don't like them. However, and we're introduced to our lead character, Izuku Midoriya, Midoriya Izuku, whichever way around you, Western, Eastern, whichever way around you personally prefer. We're probably going to switch back and forth just because my inability to keep what I've been doing thus far straight in terms of Japanese versus English naming traditions. Fair. So just roll with this, audience.
These are the two names he has.
And what we're going to... Yeah, Izuku and Midoriya. And also, crucially, Deku, because Izuku is quirkless. He doesn't have a superpower, but he's a big fan of superheroes. He's wanted to be one his whole life, and his best friend, Katsuki Bakugo, has a really great superpower, which is blowing stuff up with his sweat. This is where you're going to start noticing that some of the superpowers are deeply weird in ways I enjoy massively. It's like when you get X-Men books that are about the B-list, C-list, D-list, and Z-list X-Men, who just have, like, one feather coming out of their ear and how they saved the day once.
Yep. Blowing things up cool so with much. Your sweat. Okay, convince me.
Also canon that his sweat gives him great skin because he inherited it from his mother, who uses her quirk of sweating glycerin to be one of my favourite pieces of random trivia. So yes, his best friend has become his school bully. He's still in middle school. I'm not going to get into the schooling system. Middle school equivalent. Where he is currently in the process of applying to UA, which is the best hero school in the country, we are told, as is Katsuki, who in the first episode sort of attacks him, tells him if he wants to be a hero, he should throw himself a roof and hope for a quirk in the next life. So you're kind of watching this going, okay, yeah, I'm familiar with this setup. The poor downtrodden one is going to prove that people like him are just as good as anyone else and become a hero. And then by the end of, like, episode two, you get, no, actually...
Yeah, it's clear that that's not what's happening. Sorry, this is not a defense of the quirkless.
No. By the end of episode two, he has had a chance encounter with the number one hero, because there are rankings, which all of the heroes we find out about have an assigned rank. The number one hero is All Might, discount Captain America, who has some kind of not super well-known strength enhancement adjacent quirk.
He's tough and
he
strong.
Finds out...
It's his thing.
Yes. Izuku finds out that All Might has actually had some kind of sort of borderline career-ending injury, which means he can only maintain his All Might form for a certain period of time or day, and slips into his sort of corpse-like skinny guy form.
He keeps switching back to Steve Rogers. Like, pre-serum yeah. Rogers keeps reappearing at inconvenient times. It's very sad. Tragic.
Yeah. He swears Izuku's to secrecy. Izuku says, do you think I can be a hero even though I'm quirkless? And All Might says, no. Which is, again, so not what you were expecting at this stage in the episode slash
He tells him to just go home and live a boring life because he's never going to be cool.
It's very funny. I have at one point gotten into discourse with a friend of mine who is a trainee teacher about the degree of appropriateness of saying this. Where, like, I do actually understand there is a degree to which if you're in a very dangerous position and a child comes up to you and goes, can I do your job? Saying there are safer jobs you should consider is potentially, like, not as deranged as it comes across when you're seeing it from the perspective of the child. But it is still deeply funny.
It is very funny. The subversion of expectations.
There's some discourse about, like, how this reflects on him morally, and I'm just saying, I do see there is a both sides argument, but to me, it just comes across as deeply funny to see this small child be like, oh, okay.
Casually crush all of your hopes.
Cool. Fortunately, on the way home, he sees the same villain that All Might had just saved him from attacking Katsuki. All of the heroes are standing around doing nothing because their quirks aren't particularly good for this situation. But Izuku remembers what it was like being attacked by this villain and saves Katsuki. And this impresses All Might enough that he corners him and goes, I have to pass on my quirk to someone because I can't use it anymore. And mine is a special quirk that you can pass on to other people. And I've chosen you because you've shown true heroism. And presumably not because I feel guilty about crushing your dreams and leaving you on a roof.
Right. Sorry, I'm not sorry that I broke your heart. Unrelatedly, would you like to be cool now?
Yeah. So, I've gathered myself. I find the first couple of episodes of My Hero Academia slash the first few issues unspeakably funny. But,
have I? No, I'm here.
Sorry, you were lighting up green and I wasn't hearing noise. I got nervous.
Sorry. No, I mean, my connection's so yes, a little choppy, but I'm still here.
Cool. Okay, yes. So, after this, that's kind of the setup we get. After this, the early adventures involve Izuku getting into UA school, the entrance exam. This is where you dropped out. It also means you didn't get to meet any of my personal favourites, because I actually find the main character most things not my favourites. I think that's pretty common, which means you have to wait a while for someone interesting to show up in most media.
True.
But yeah, so we then move into him getting into UA, the adventures he has there, and the emergence of the bad guys. So we first meet them in kind of a random isolated attack directed at All Might that the kids get caught in. We subsequently see them targeting this class in specific, and that they are actually sort of, they're not ring-led, but shadow-guided from supported by an ancient enemy of All Might's who is called All for One, which is the name of his quirk. It's the counterpart to All Might's quirk, One for All. And the idea is there's a sort of history to these two quirks. One has been passed from person to person. The other one is owned by the original owner, but he's immortal because of his ability to take other people's quirks for himself. So you see there's this kind of, you know, balance set up. Izuku has now inherited this ancient enemy.
Lucky Izuku.
Again, seems good for you, I guess. And I'm not going to get into the actual details of any further plot until it's relevant to our points. So I've just given you kind of a setup of like the first series or so of the anime, the first couple of dozen issues of the manga situation.
Yeah.
What you might notice I didn't mention in there is any degree of like social context, despite this being a thing that's introduced very early.
Right. What's going on with the society around these quirks?
So yeah, we are going to loop back to that, but this is just sort of the baseline setup that I think you're going to need to understand my future points, because now we're going to very briefly introduce the concept of postmodern literature.
Please, I am even postmodern literature than I am of regular literature.
So kind of like when you did post-structuralism, postmodernism is very much like, to some extent, defined by what it's not, which is obviously modern literature, except that it's not. There's a lot of overlap between the two. Modernism, it's kind of hard to define. There's kind of, much like structuralism we talked about, there's sort of philosophical and artistic and kind of everything from political to architectural to philosophical, I already said that one, elements to it. Within literature, what you see kind of associated with in modernism is this idea of grand narratives and this idea that you can epitomize a search for metaphorical, metaphysical even, truths through this single emblematic story of a guy. Sometimes the guy is a woman, but it's fundamentally a guy.
Right.
So you might think of something like Heart of Darkness or Gatsby, where you have this main character who you're following as they encounter someone else's grand narrative, and a character who through their story inspires the narrator of the story to understand some great hidden truth about humanity.
Mm-hmm.
A lot of it is sort of rejecting the earliest versions of gritty realism in favour of sort of epicism.
Right. I mean, so
I'm not getting into the weeds of the concept of modernism, but that's sort of the baseline. Right. I'm just
making sure I've got this sort of straight in my head. So we're not kind of trying to do realism. We are doing that thing where you sort of deliberately heighten the stakes and the themes, yeah, because the themes and the themes and motifs are the story you are trying to tell. So you are not, you're not trying to maintain things on like a regular human scale necessarily.
Yeah.
You're instead going, we are telling the story of a guy trying to, you know, balance his job with his wife, and we're doing this through Superman.
Yeah. And I could do days on modernism and early comic books, but we're not going to, because we're talking about postmodernism and also comic books.
Let's just assume that I am correct in my understanding, even if a very basic form of correct, and move on to postmodernism.
So postmodernism, we're not going to get into the weeds of the timing. There's some amount of overlap, but it's very much a reaction to modernism. So it's not exclusively just stuff that happened after modernism. It's in response to it. It's in dialogue with it. It's a school of literature that's very abstract in way. It is still highly thematic, but I think you'd struggle to find a school of literature which isn't. I did look up some definitions to help me explain this, and a lot of things were like, postmodern literature has themes, and I'm like, as opposed to what?
Right, as opposed to all of that literature, which isn't about anything, and was written by accident.
You know how sometimes you pick up a book and it's about nothing?
Right.
But yes, so postmodern literature is much less about this kind of big, grand narrative idea. You tend to get a lot of sort of diorama-y literature, where you're moving from scene to scene. You get a lot of metafiction, a lot of intertextual stuff. You get a lot of unreliable narration. It's the idea is that it is much more consumed with the act of reading than the act of storytelling.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think I certainly recognize the sort of diorama style, where you have, you know, little vignettes, and there's not so much a theme as a mood.
Yeah, that's not the only type of sort of postmodern you get, but if you look at sort of modernist literature, you might say something like Ulysses, The Wasteland, is, even if it's very abstract and metaphorical, it's abstract and metaphorical in the sense that it is a description of this day, this place, this guy.
Yeah, it's quite concrete. It tends to be quite abstraction, which is a weird thing to say, but you get me.
Yeah. Whereas sort of postmodernism is much more likely to give you kind of your Rashomon approach. It's much more likely to give you a sort of Lemony Snicket-esque narrator. You're gonna have more of the little signposts you hang on literature to say this is being literary.
Mm-hmm. It's almost more self-conscious about what it's doing.
Yeah. And so one of the things that's, so a couple of things that are very common, sense of like playfulness with the literature. So this is the thing with not just having self-aware, often unreliable narration, but also in terms of having like quite black self-aware comedy. There's a sense of sort of an irony is common, a sense of playfulness, an idea that you are, by writing a story, you are engaging in a dialogue, and that dialogue is not necessarily fun, but a game you're playing with the reader. It's a takes two to tango school of literature, as opposed to this is my story and you are consuming it school of literature.
Yeah, yeah. I am setting out not necessarily even to tell a story, but to have, to provoke a response from you, the reader.
Yeah, this is where you start to get like stuff like, well, not the very earliest, but a lot of stuff like magic realism. I read a lot of really interesting stuff this week about how the first jukebox musicals are debatably postmodernist that I want to write an essay on because it's fascinating. It's engaging with form, and also it's, in the same way, it's metafictional, it's intertextual. So that means pretty much it's referring to its own nature as a story and also referring to other stories. Mm-hmm. You're maybe catching my emphasis on that last bit and how it factors into my thoughts about My Hero Academia.
Right. I can definitely see that My Hero Academia is starting from a position of assuming that you, the reader, understand this genre and therefore understand when the genre is being sent up, subverted, any of these things.
Yeah. And My Hero Academia is not light-handed with its intertextual references.
Bring them on its sleeve, yeah.
You may remember when you read the, when you watched, sorry, the first few episodes, did you notice any of the place names?
No. Or if I did, I did not remember noticing them.
It's a bit harder for English language readers to pick up on, but the place names all have something in common.
Are they all, like, Gotham and things?
It's slightly weirder than that. So, like, you may notice that, like, there's a major conflict in Hosu, but that doesn't take place in the first one. There's a place called Aldera, a place called Musutafu. This might not be immediately obvious listening to anyone listening, just because I am not naturally a Japanese speaker, but these are all places from Star Wars.
I don't know enough about Star Wars either. Okay.
Hoth, Mustafa. I have... There's just quite a few of them.
Heard of Hoth, I think.
Naboo exists.
Okay.
I find this unspeakably funny just because it's never referenced or brought up again.
Right. It's not like a plot point that these places are Star Wars named. It's just a funny little thing they've thrown in that also the places have Star Wars names.
Yeah, so like this is just my example of wearing your intertextuality on your sleeves.
Right. Not being like, I am a serious piece of literature that has never been affected by any other piece of literature. Like, nope.
Yes, this is not the grand epic of Midoriya Izuku. This is, look, the places have Star Wars names.
Right.
I love that. And obviously, this is a universe where when humanity developed superpowers, and we know roughly when this happened, it's only a few generations back, there was a glowing baby and then super people started being born. People developed superpowers. Society descended into chaos. And then people went, hey, you remember comic books? That seemed like a great system for policing this new world.
Let us consciously emulate the comic book.
This is, in my humble opinion, one of the most iconic approaches to metafictional narrative in history is the canon backstory of this universe is
rebuilding
society was collapsing, so we rebuilt it based on Batman.
Right. I have looked at the world.
Well, not Batman. Everyone but Batman.
I have looked at the world. I have seen that it is in shambles. And what I'm going to do about this is create Professor X's Academy.
It's incredible.
I do like that. I'm not saying it's a good idea. I don't want to encourage this in real life. But as a setting, that is amazing.
I don't know, man. I think at this point in society, I would rather live in Gotham.
To be honest, you know, if everyone develops superpowers, we can revisit this question.
I mean, again, Batman was the worst choice of example. He does not have the superpowers. It's just that's the first superpower that comes into my brain.
Actually, Batman has the most crucial superpower, which is he has the power of being the protagonist.
He does.
He's also very
and
rich.
And also huge amounts of money. You
can do a lot with money. Yeah. But I think his actual, like, metaphysical superpower is that of protagonism.
I think his metaphysical superpower is being the opposite of Superman. It's almost like, we need to come up with another superhero character who's a protagonist.
But now we're back in Jung, because he's not like the opposite, like the reverse, but the opposite, like the shadow.
Yeah, he's the opposite in the sense of, we need to catch the kids who haven't been interested in this Superman character we came up with. What would other kids like?
Right. What's the reverse marketing? Well, instead of all the colours, he wears black and is cool.
Yeah. Anyway, aside from Batman,
who is Mr. Two?
It's very rare that I.
Yeah, apart from superhero not appearing in this show.
Yeah. So this is the thing, right? So this is a universe that is sort of, to its very core, metatextual, and this is something that I personally find really interesting because My Hero Academia has a very weird approach to themes. Mm-hmm. So I brought this up when you gave me your summary, which is it seems like it sets up a lot of very obvious, I don't want to say trite, but like kind of after school specialty themes, right? It's like it goes, oh, this is the one kid who's not as special as everyone else, but he's going to be the specialist, or everybody underestimates you, but you're going to do the best. And like those things are, we're told that he does become the best. We're told this very early on, like this is the story of how I became the number one hero type situation. But those aren't like plot points that come up with any degree of frequency.
Mm-hmm.
We kind of just told them at A. And then we move on to B, C, D, and E plots. And we don't revisit point A.
Yeah.
And this is a thing that My Hero Academia does a lot. So, like, my personal favourite example of this is Shinzo Hitoshi, who is one of my favourite characters. You won't have met him. He shows up in the sports tournament arc, because of course there's a sports tournament arc.
Of course, we are, after all, school anime.
Yeah, this is still school anime. Of course they're going to have a beating the shit out of each other section.
An officially sanctioned one to break up the unofficial, unsanctioned.
Yes. Hey, to be fair, there are hero licenses, so some of this is technically sanctioned. so there is a tournament arc, because of course there's a tournament arc. All of the kids are made to compete in it, despite the fact that they have just recovered from some pretty significant trauma of like being attacked by supervillains and having their teacher beaten up in front of them and nearly dying.
Walk it off.
Apparently, they need to continue with the televised school sports tournament because they don't want to look like the school is in any way weakened by one of the teachers nearly dying. Two of the teachers nearly dying, sorry.
That does sound like a thing a school would do in regards to its sports day.
Yeah. I mean, at least with the concrete thing, they closed the schools physically.
Right.
Even if they relocated them to Zoom, like, at least they were, like, not putting children the...
They didn't say just come in every morning and just, you know, hold the ceiling up.
Hope you don't die. Yeah. You know, when my nursery school had to have all the asbestos taken out of it, we moved to another building.
Right, but the school in My Hero Academia would not do that.
No, they'd just press on and think of England. School sports tournament, they're all competing, and they find out right before the school sports tournament, because they've had this villain attack, all of the other classes are veering to get them, especially the Gen Ed course. A kid in the Gen Ed course, which is general education, they're the people who are at this school, but they're not training to be heroes or work with heroes in any way. It's just normal classes.
They're just the cannon fodder.
Yeah. The kids from the Gen Ed course, at least one of them that we meet, tried to get into the hero track and couldn't because the hero exam, which is the point where you dropped out, is very physical. You have to fight robots. And not everyone can fight robots with their superpowers. Some people have superpowers that are good for fighting human people.
Or even not fighting at all.
Yeah. One of these is Shinzo Hitoshi. So this is a kid who, he didn't get past the entrance exam because his superpower is brainwashing. He shows up to say, well, actually, if I win the sports tournament, I can get into the hero class that way. So everybody who wants to be in the hero classes is going to be aiming to beat you all up at the sports tournament to get scouted.
Uh-huh.
Extremely normal way to conduct a school.
Extremely.
Yeah. And so he makes it through rounds 1 and 2. I'm not going to get into the weeds. Round 3 is 1-to-1 duels, because of course it is. And Shinzo gets paired up with our lead character, Izuku. And what happens is, this is actually used in a very utilitarian sense. Shinzo brainwashes him, and this is how Midoriya / Izuku, again, I'm just going to use names interchangeably, I'm sorry, is able to break out of his brainwashing because the ghosts of the previous owners of his quirk are able to snap him out of it, which should have been impossible.
Oh, the creators watched Avatar.
Yeah, so this is done in a very, like, utilitarian way to help us find out about these residues of the quirk, and it leads us into a lot more learning about his quirk, one for all. But I'm just going to ignore that very important plot beat to focus on how this affects the kid who he beats, Shinzo. Shinzo is something of a fan favourite. Like, he was very much like a not one-off, but like background character. He pretty much shows up, explains, this society sucks for me because I have a quirk that inherently frightens other people, right? It's brainwashing. It makes people feel like they've lost their autonomy. People can't really talk to me because the way my quirk works is if I ask a question and someone answers it, I can control them.
Right.
Everyone thinks of me as a villain to be.
Right. My quirk is inherently evil.
Yeah.
Or at least, yeah, like the rules of story say that anyone with a quirk like mine must become a villain.
Yeah. And because we live in a society that is based on comic books, that means everyone must assume that I am villainous, inherently.
Right. We have chosen a poetic model for our society, which is that of the comic book, which is a choice we have accepted as part of the setting. We're just going to go with it. But under that poetic model, that thing we are emulating, a quirk like brainwashing clearly codes villainous.
Yeah.
And you've set up a society where if you have a quirk that codes villainous, that just means you are coded villainous as a person.
Exactly. And so he shows up, he explains all of this and says, I want to be a hero. It's what I want. He doesn't really give a reasoning, which I find fascinating, because it would be very easy to be like, I'm a good person and I want to prove that people like me aren't villains. It's very much left understated. In fact, once he's defeated, Izuku comes over to have a bit of a one-to-one chat with him, and he just goes, I can't help what I want. I want to be a superhero. I can't help that.
Well, that's so, you know, valid. Very... I love this kid.
I love him. He is my favourite character, despite the fact that he is in literally, like, I cannot stress enough. He does reappear later, but in the context of his introduction, he does very much show off, go, here are my intentions, here is my tragic backstory, oh shit, I lost, and then vanishes.
Again, huge mood.
I cannot stress enough how much he just fucking disappears.
We've all had an embarrassing social situation and decided to simply never return.
But can I just point out narratively how unfair it is that he is up against the kid with the haunted quirk that no one could possibly know about? Like, he actually had every right to think he was going to nail that tournament. and get his wish.
Oh, absolutely. What he's suffering from there, actually, is a lack of protagonism.
Yeah, he's just not the protagonist, and there are several fanfics setting this to rights.
I'm happy for this child and his,
I know,
his vindication in fanfic.
And he does ultimately get trained by their teacher, who is one of my other favourite characters, Aizawa-sensei, who I just think is one of the most fun characters. He has the ability to turn off other people's quirks, which I just think is neat. And
that's
he has a character design I think is fun. And eventually he starts training Shizuo, because they're both fan favorites, as far as I can tell. I'm sure this was narratively planned because they have a lot, like, visually and common design wise, but I also do think that the fact that they are both fan favorite characters and this was a popular headcanon wasn't not a thing.
That's just good writing when you're doing this kind of serial fiction.
Yeah. This is not a comic which is afraid of the audience correctly interpreting foreshadowing, which I, for one, appreciate.
Oh no, you guessed where I was going. I must now have an unearned twist.
Exactly. Like, no, 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 the twists are earned. Some of them are stupid, but they're earned. So yeah, I've skipped us over to Shinso's episode and the sports tournament, partly because this is kind of emblematic of the point I'm making, is there is this thing that happens a lot where somebody walks on screen, trauma dumps, and then waltzes off to stage left. And
along with having one embarrassing social situation and never returning, an extreme first year of university vibe.
I know, right? I so feel for these kids. They're like 14, 15. I'm like, yeah, you know what? That is what I was like at 15. I would just appear, share facts about myself.
I'm making friends. I'm just going to tell them all about my tragic backstory.
Yeah.
Do awkward finger guns. Never return.
Yep. It is a big mood. But my point being, the sports tournament is actually a high point for this, because the sports tournament is also where fan favorite main character Todoroki reveals his personal damage. And like, he's kind of just been like the weird cool dude. You know, a lot of animes have like the cool guy in the class.
Yep.
The like one who like just looks at people derogatorily.
Right. He's unflappable.
Yeah, he's unflappable. He has a cool character design. He has a facial scar.
Yeah.
All of these are signs. Cool anime character. He also has the best quirk, I'm sorry. He has half hot, half cold, which is he's like a bilateral chimera, and one side of him has like fire powers and the other half has ice powers.
The left hand indeed does not know what the right hand is doing.
He's extremely cool. And he is the son of the number two hero, Endeavor, who is a fire-based superhero, Human Torch style.
Does he have the whole thing about being second best?
He absolutely does. How did you predict that? So what we find out in the sports tournament arc is that Todoroki's parents, Endeavor and, I've forgotten his mother's name, Ray, that was it, are in something called a quirk marriage, which is where somebody has sought out a partner who has a desirable quirk.
Oh, it's when you're doing eugenics to yourselves.
For whatever reason, yep. It's absolutely eugenicsy. Because he, basically, Endeavor can only handle his upper heat limit for a certain period of time. And he wanted his children to not have that weakness so they could become greater heroes than him and usurp All Might from the top spot as number one.
A normal thing to want and to base your marriage around.
Exactly. So within about 2 minutes of that reveal, we find out that his wife, Rei, at some point after the birth of Todoroki, had a psychotic break, mistook her infant son for her dirtbag husband, and poured boiling water directly onto his face. And that's how he got the scar.
That is a tragic backstory. Full tragic backstory. Full tragedy.
Yeah. Rei is now in a institution of some kind. I don't think we have many details. And Shoto Todoroki, that's, you know, the classmate, the cool guy, is out of sort of, I don't want to say petty, because the situation deserves more than pettiness, but I feel like the vibe is petty, like the attitude has petty energy, despite the absolute legitimateness of the complaint.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know if there's a word for that emotion. Is refusing to use his fire powers because he wants to prove that he can be the best with just his mum's powers. This seems to me like a very interesting way to rebel, because it is achieving the same goal that Endeavor wants. Just
right, but in a way that will annoy him.
Yeah. It is also, in a way I can't quite put into words, I've got this in my notes, with like a lot of lines pointing to other words in the sentence. It's very emotionally real as the response of a traumatized child who doesn't actually dare be fully disobedient.
Right. It's very much, I am still doing the thing I have been told to do that I will not get in trouble for. And it's just stylistic rebellion.
Yeah. It's aesthetic rebellion. It's very weird. I fully support this, yeah. I support this kid no matter what he does, not gonna lie. Todoroki deserves better. My campaign slogan. I'm not the only one. I'm pretty sure it's an AO3 tag. But yeah, so we find all of this out after Izuku's like overheard Endeavor yelling at Shota Todoroki in the like changing rooms at the sports festival. Izuku's been knocked out. Todoroki ends up against Bakugo. Bakugo and Todoroki have their big fight, and Bakugo basically is going off the charts feral because he's insulted that someone is fighting him at half power. A lot of people hate him. I think he is the funniest character. He is so believable as a shithead 15-year-old.
Oh, yeah. Like, getting extremely insulted that somebody isn't taking you seriously enough to, like, kill you properly.
He is at all times the "I am confused when we are not about me" bird meme. He's like, "I'm sorry, what are you talking about? You have damage from your past. You are looking at me, therefore I'm the only thing that matters."
Right. Why are we not talking about my past? And my damage.
He's very funny. But Izuku pretty much yells, like, "Both of your superpowers are yours, Todoroki! Use your fire! Win!" And Todoroki does use his fire, does actually not win. It is a very, very weird little vignette. And this is all within, so like, the Shinso stuff, the Todoroki stuff, the fight after the Todoroki stuff, this is all within the span of about, like, 40 pages max of manga. Maybe an hour of anime screen time. This is so much information to take on about the world building of this universe.
Right, there's a lot happening here.
And then they just go straight on with the next bit of narrative.
Right, we don't need to dwell on any of this. We don't need to dwell on the fact that there's a whole eugenics subculture.
Yeah, no. We don't need to think about that. Like, literally, I went to the, as I usually do, I have the Wikipedia page open in front of me so I can double check, like, names and order of events as we go. If I scroll down to the summary, the sentences go like this. "Due to the information that the League of Villains possesses about the inner workings of UA, the faculty begin to suspect there may be a traitor at the school. After participating in a sports festival, Izuku and his classmates Shota Todoroki and Tenya Iida confront the villain Stain and defeat him." Do you notice how none of this is in that summary? Because none of it is relevant to the plot.
It's just also happening.
It is a 6-word aside after participating in a sports festival.
Right, a sports festival is the correct summary for all the events we have just covered.
Oh my god, and like, don't get me wrong, it's not like they then move on to completely unrelated, like, it's time to have an action scene now. No, the villain Stain stuff is also deeply involved in the moral world building. Like, the villain Stain is a villain who kills heroes he perceives as being heroes for like reasons other than genuine heroism.
Oh, he's doing some sort of ideological weeding.
Yeah, he's like what's his face? Taskmaster? Is that the one I'm thinking of? There's like a variety of comic book villains with this kind of gimmick. He's weeding out superheroes he thinks of as being superheroes for insufficient reasons.
Right. You're just not... We're going to do a series of highly contrived tests where only through true altruism can you survive and return to heroing, and everyone else must suffer.
Yeah, except he doesn't do tests. He just shows up and murders them. He seems to have some kind of prior criterion that we know nothing about.
I respect the efficiency.
Yeah, I mean... fair enough. And from there we go straight into meeting more villains, including, and this is where we're going to get in back into my thematic points, two more fan favorites. Uh-huh. Also, I think it's around here we find out that the League of Villains is what they're called, which I just want to reference because I think it's adorable. the League of Villains.
The League of Villains. The Brotherhood of Mutants, if you will.
You know the Brotherhood of Evil Mutants? I don't know if you ever saw that post that used to be quite popular.
I always forget that it's the Brotherhood of Evil Mutants, because that's just...
I've always liked the Brotherhood of Evil Mutants, because I had it pointed out to me, I think this is on Tumblr, it might have been on some fan forum in the 2000s. Like, it sounds ridiculous that they're called the Brotherhood of Evil Mutants, and they're like, no, we're for a good cause. But to be fair, if someone asked me to join the Brotherhood of Evil Queers, I would be so down.
Right, I think when you remember that they are fundamentally an anarchist activist group, it suddenly makes perfect sense that that's what they call themselves.
Of course they do. Of sodding course they do.
But it is also adorable.
I also always get the impression that Magneto doesn't like the name.
I think, well, this is why I forget it, because I think in the films he just calls it the Brotherhood.
Yeah.
Which I do think is what he would do. He'd be like, okay, I can't make them change the name, but I do not have to say it.
No one can make me identify as a member of the Brotherhood of Evil Mutants, you losers. Anyway, yes, so we find out that the League of Villains is called the League of Villains. We've already met a few of them in the villain skirmish with the school I mentioned earlier, including Shigaraki, who's got like a cool hands all over him design and the power to turn anything to dust by touching it.
That's
which
hardcore.
I understand is clearly very inconvenient in life, but is also such a cool superpower.
And also just reverse Midas.
I know, right? Like, it's cool. I really like it. Just on an aesthetic level, I feel like, again, it would be very inconvenient, and I understand why. This is also, it's interesting that we meet him first and then we get the Shinso bit where he's like, hey, do you have any idea how much it sucks to have a superpower that makes everyone think you're doomed to be evil forever? It doesn't,
you're already
like,
introduced to the idea of superpowers as unwanted destiny.
Yeah, and up to this point, I think all of the villains we've met have had gross and or creepy powers. So we've had like Dust Guy, we've had Sludge Villain Guy who drowned some kids, we've had Stain,
that
who
is
has blood licking based superpowers.
Like, I'm not saying the sludge itself is necessarily villainous, but at the point you use your sludge to drown kids, you have committed to the villain lifestyle.
Yeah, absolutely. But like, all of the villains we've met so far have in fact had fairly villainy TM superpowers. I think the next couple we meet, though, are some more of the League of Villains, which has a variety of superpower guys. There's a lizardy guy. There's a magic guy. I can't actually remember the order they're introduced or if they're all at once or not offhand. There's one who I personally adore, which is the like teenage girl, like bouncy excited one who can shapeshift by drinking people's blood. Another blood superpower is surprisingly popular.
It's delicious and nutritious.
A guy called Dabby, who has blue fire powers and also burn scars all over him. I think this issue had been out for about 10 minutes before the first people guessing that he was one of Endeavor's other children were around.
That seems like a reasonable guess based on the information we've had so far. Yeah,
genuinely, I would say 10 to 15 minutes this was in the universe before people were going, I got it, I know. But yes, Dabby has burn scars all over him and blue fire, very, very hot superpowers. And it's interesting because Dabby is the first character we meet who has a not incredibly villainous superpower and yet is a villain. Mm-hmm. And he has the same power as the hero we've just found out like a couple of hours ago in screen time is a dirtbag. This is what I mean when I say it's not that it's bringing up themes and then dropping them. It's bringing up themes and then throwing them at you like rotten fruit.
Right. It's not like forgetting it has themes. It's just hitting you with a theme in much the manner as being hit with a snowball.
Like, it's deeply devoted to the feeding you theme.
Right, but then it ends up doing what sounds like a very disjointed... Look, there's a theme here, moving on.
Yeah, and this is kind of where I'm getting to. I'm making the transition. I'm going to be jumping between the two. I'm making the transition from metatextual to intertextual and vice versa. This is kind of where I'm getting into the metatextual. It's so self-referential. It feels like you're kind of in a world where you're just expected to take all of this information on board in a way that feels weirdly true to how real life social understandings come to exist in your brain.
Interesting. Go on.
Well, it's this very weird thing where it feels in a strange way much more socially real than, say, X-Men, from which I would say it does borrow heavily, mm-hmm. just in terms of like the stylist realistic nature of a world of superpowers. It's much more X-Men than it is DC Metahumans, Marvel Inhumans, whatever.
Sure.
It feels like it could be like a distant future that everybody has the X gene now, X-Men fanfic. You know what I mean?
Yeah, I mean, X-Men compared to sort of other superhero sort of world-building states has built in the idea that there's loads of mutants. Anyone could be a mutant. There will always, you know, there will always be another mutant, and also there will always be more mutants than there were yesterday. As opposed to something like, you know, nothing about Superman says that there will be an ever-increasing number of Supermen. Whereas X-Men has that built-in that there will be an ever-increasing number.
Superman is an endangered species.
Right. Whereas X-Men kind of has built-in that sooner or later, the mutants will outnumber the normal people. That is, in fact, a major premise of why no one, why sort of politically they do not have many friends.
Yeah. And this is the thing, is like, this isn't unusual in kind of any kind of superpower shonen manga and anime. Like, it's very much the preferred form of superpower is everyone has a unique one. That's very much just like, within the genre, the favorite version of superpowers or magic powers.
Uh-huh.
It's not big on the sort of magic school, this is how magic works variety.
Yeah.
Obviously, that's a massive generalization to make about a genre. Please don't email
me. Do not at us. We are not saying this is a universal statement. We are describing a theme and indeed a trend.
Look, I've already told you that my favorite anime is Detective Conan. If you think like I don't have some obscure stuff backed up in my brain. My second favorite anime is Tokyo. My second favorite anime is Tokyo ESP, which maybe four people have ever seen.
I like the one with the cooking school and also the one with the tanks.
Oh, Girls and Panzer is so good. Anyway, my point being, it's very interesting to compare this approach to giving us the social world of My Hero Academia to something like X-Men, or for that matter, Tokyo ESP, where X-Men, while X-Men approaches a lot of sociological, sociopolitical issues, it kind of puts them all through the same lens, right? It's...
Uh-huh.
These are the mutants. They've always been around, but we're seeing more and more of them lately, and we're scared. And you can map that onto whatever social issue you, as an author, want to write about, feel capable of writing about, etc.
Right. It is it is very flexible in terms of any ethnic group, religious group, minoritized sexuality, anything, really.
Yeah, and X-Men does do some really interesting things.
You could make the X-Men into a metaphor about, you know, communist witch hunts at universities.
Yeah, and like one of, and X-Men does do some really interesting things with this. One of my favorite X-Men issues ever is an issue of All New, All Different X-Men, where a queer kid with a visible mutation runs away from school to go on a date and basically has a horrible time. Let's not get into it. And two of the X-Men, one of whom is queer and one of whom has a visible mutation, go after him. And neither of them can get through to him on their own. And they have to work together to say, hey, we can't, neither of us can 100% understand where you're coming from, but we both understand some of it. And we're both here to support you no matter what. It's one of my favorite X-Men comics ever. It's really underrated. Partly because no one likes North Star. Because, I don't know, there's only room for one cool Canadian X-Man. Whatever. What is the singular of X-Men? Is it X-Men?
It's X-Men.
It's a unit of X-Men. But yes, sort of. X-Men does a lot of really interesting stuff with this, but it is all through the lens of being a mutant. Whereas My Hero Academia takes place in a world where everybody developed superpowers, but we didn't like put away the social problems that existed before that. We just have a new world now which has the same number of problems in it. Possibly more.
We have reskinned some of them.
Yeah.
But we haven't actually solved anything.
So I mentioned the League of Villains. One of the villains we actually meet later on is somebody called Magne, who is a transgender woman in the League of Villains.
Uh-huh.
Which is just very interesting to me.
Yes, I mean, that's a rich scenario for interpretation.
Yeah, like I'm not going to go too much into the details of this character. This is more just an example. Like, if you search, I don't recommend you do this. If you go onto the My Hero Academia and look for trans people, there are two characters who are listed in the category of transgender. It's not really discussed. It's more just they are drawn in a way that sort of implies.
Suggestive.
Yeah. They're both sort of drawn with very masculine figures and are referred to as female.
Yeah.
I mean, we don't really know that much about...
In a graphic medium, short of outright saying so, that's sort of how you do that.
Yeah. We don't know that much about them. One of them's a hero, one of them's a villain. They show up at about the same time. The point being, social issues from the real world come up, and social issues from the real world that are actually very specifically Japanese come up that are, like, really misunderstood by the fandom at large. I'm not going to claim to be an expert, but a lot of the stuff with Endeavor and his family is based around Japanese social norms that, oh my god, have led to some really bad fan discourse.
I do not love fan discourse, I have to say. It is not my favourite part of fandom.
This is the thing, is I personally don't like the Endeavor storyline because I just don't... I don't love storylines about redemption of shitty parents, which put the shitty parents' feelings front and centre. I sure. think they're valid and worth telling and interesting. They're just not for me.
Right, all valid. With you on all parts of that.
Yeah, so like, I personally do not like the storyline. That does not mean that several of the detractors of this storyline are not off their rockers. Like, look, I'm not saying this anime or manga are perfect. I'm not even saying that there isn't a huge amount of abuse apologism going on. I just feel like if you are a, like, you know, 20-something Westerner reading this, going, hey, this seems like a bad family... And the, like, readers from Japan are going, yeah, it's talking about a very specific social issue we have here. And you go, no, it's just about bad stuff. I just feel like you're missing something.
Right, and at that point, you're sort of willfully missing something, which is not a good look.
Yeah, it's weird. Like, I know I'm missing something. It doesn't make me any less uncomfortable with the thing I'm reading, but I'm sort of aware I'm missing something.
Right, enjoyment, though, is different from... belief that there could be more depth to the interpretation.
Yeah. I did actually have the next, like, a couple more story arcs bookmarked to, like, walk you through, but I am aware that I am going, like, slowly, because I keep making myself
laugh. We are looking like we might run long, yes.
But I'll rattle you through a couple more points, just sort of quick fire, rather than going into them in depth.
Yeah, yeah.
One of the next arcs we get is an arc about Yakuza who are developing a bullet that takes away people's quirks because they think that the new quirk society is, like, bad for organized crime, which is, again, wild.
As motivations go, that one is very funny.
It is so funny. And it's also combined really horribly with, like, a small child being used to create these bullets. It's like, it ricochets from very funny concepts to really troubling execution so fast.
Right, that's gone from funny to disturbing.
It is so fast. The next one we get is a sort of X-Men arc, which is why I wanted to make sure I referenced it, which is there's a whole group that are super anti people with animal parts, heteromorphic quirks, that's the phrase. So people who have, like, animal body parts and things like that as part of their quirk. They actually get defeated by Shigaraki, the leader of the League of Villains. So there's, like, inter-villain social justice drama. I don't even know what's happening anymore.
Internecine beef between self-semi... Well, this is an interesting question, actually. Are they, like, self-appointed villains, or is it...
Have they been made
villains? Have they achieved villainy?
This is the thing, is like the ones we meet who are plot important seem to have very much self-identified themselves as villains in kind of a, I don't want to say reclaimed because that's not the word I'm looking for, but I don't know another word for what they're doing, which is...
Embraced, perhaps.
I am, yeah, like embraced, but in a I am attacking you way.
Yeah.
It's the long-line wire.
You just follow that up with, you know, sludge attacks.
Yeah, like, the ones we meet are kind of loud and proud villains. I don't think that it's implied that that is the norm. I think it's implied that the norm is that villainy just means, like, someone using their quirk for destructive things.
Right.
That's just not what we're talking about in these guys.
Right, we're dealing with the flamboyantly villainous.
Yeah. And this is where I'm looping us back to the sort of last plot point that I'm discussing. This isn't the last plot point in the entire... Obviously, it's still ongoing. Loads of stuff is happening. But the one we're talking... The last plot point we're talking about, because I just think it draws things neatly into a circle, is Dabby, the villain with the fire quirk I mentioned earlier.
Mm-hmm. The one with the blue fire and the burn hats.
Yeah. Goes on national TV to announce that he is Endeavor's son. And that he became a villain because of his dad's abuse. At this
point,
we've
got some interesting contrasts between him and his presumably half brother.
Full brother. They are all children of the same woman in this quirk marriage. It's that so Todoroki has three older siblings, all of whom did not get the quirk the dad wanted. If at first you don't succeed.
And were therefore removed from the
plot.
Family unit in some way, yes.
I mean, to be fair, we did see a picture of two of his older siblings, and we actually do meet his older sister at one point. I don't remember if we meet the brother or not. He might just be forgettable. That's so mean.
Have an interesting contrast between I have been rejected by my abusive father and have therefore embraced villainy, and I have been placed under excessive expectations by my abusive father and have therefore embraced still doing what he wants but in a way he wouldn't like.
Yeah. And so a little plot development happened while all the other stuff I was ricketing you through happened. All Might, the number one hero, has been forced to retire because he used the very last of his superpower to wreck you. He is not particularly All Might.
He's just a guy.
Yeah, which means that Endeavor is the number one hero. Endeavor has 100% achieved his goal at this point.
He's
he is
not
the
what
number
he
one
always
hero.
Wanted, but not in the way he wanted to do it.
Yeah. This is why I thought this was a neat place to end our, like, the bit of My Hero Academia that we're covering is there's, like, a whole little drama happening in that corner. There's a whole little drama happening in that corner. I didn't even get into Hawks, and he's one of my favourite characters.
To be fair, it's a big anime. This I have gleaned is that there's a lot of it, and it roams widely, so we can't really cover
it. It roams widely. There's prequels, there's midquels, there's a lot going on, there's differences between the anime and the manga. There's a lot happening. I've led you through the parts that I think are relevant.
To like 90 minutes, so we can't cover all of it.
Yeah, don't worry. I'm getting to the end. I've edited it down to the parts that are relevant to my point, though having reference Hawks, I am going to very briefly bring up how entertaining I find his backstory. This is another one of those, like, show up, dump your backstory, and then exit stage left pursued by trauma. Hawks is, I think when we're introduced to him, he's the number three hero. He's, like, extremely cool. He's very popular as a cosplay. He's got, like, a little flight jacket and big red wings that he can turn, and he can control his feathers and use them to spy, but also use them as weapons. It's a very fun superpower.
Very cool.
I know, it's a really rad superpower. And you're like, wow, this guy seems, like, carbon designed to be a cool
cosplay
superhero. And then you find out in-universe he genuinely is. Because what happened is, he was the son of, like, a two-bit thief. Who was like a shitty dad. His mum was like sort of just either drunk or just like checked out, not entirely clear.
Uh-huh.
And he had like a generally pretty rubbish life. He was a big fan of Endeavor until one day he like saved some people in a car crash or something. And the, I keep wanting to say HSBC, that's a bank.
That is a bank.
They're
probably not in this anime.
Yeah. What are they called? They're not HSBC. This is why I'm thinking it's going to go down quite a lot once we edit out all of my trying to find things in my notes. I used paper notes this time. I usually don't. I'm regretting that decision.
Paper notes seem like a great idea until you realize you can't control F.
Yeah. HPSC. Okay.
To be fair, that's confusable.
I know. I keep wanting to say HSBC, which is a bank. The HPSC, which is the Hero Public Safety Mission, spotted this kid using his very cool, like, fun-looking, like, powerful quirk to save people, and went, hey, he would be a great choice to be a hero when he's a grown-up. And rather than be like, let's remove
you
from your
abuse... He'd be marketable.
Yeah, he seems marketable. And rather than be like, hey, kid, you want to get out of your awful home life and, like, maybe go to school, get a good foster parent, something like that, they, as far as we're told, they just kind of kidnapped him. And put him into, like, superhero training when he's like 10.
Guys, what do we know? Guys, we've been down the child soldier route before. We know it is a bad idea.
Again, like, it's not that this isn't delved into. It's just that it does have the same energy that a lot of the character backstories have, where it does have this slight, like, and that's me vibe.
And now that I've explained to you that I am the bird kids from Maximum Ride.
Literally the kids from Maximum Ride. It's...
Later!
Yeah, and he is also not the point, but very funny to me. We're introduced to him when he's sent to spy on the League of Villains. Like, oh yeah, he won't be conspicuous.
He doesn't stand out.
You know, the guy...
No distinctive features.
The guy who is the number three hero? With the giant red wings, you know that guy?
No memorable features. He will blend.
To be fair, he doesn't go in disguise. He actually just sort of rocks up when Dabby is recruiting and goes, hey, actually, the society in which I am instrumental sucks. And it's very weird because it's not obvious that he's spying, but also it feels obvious that he should have some major issues with the society that he lives in.
On account of the whole child soldier deal, yeah.
Yeah. But it's like it's not gone into. It's just not gone into that much, you know.
I'm just saying you should endeavor to raise your children, like, individually and collectively, in a way where if they turn up to a self-declared group of villains and say, "Hey, I'd like to defect," it doesn't seem immediately plausible based on how you've treated them that they would want to do that.
Yeah,
you should try not to be a trauma dump tragic backstory.
Yeah.
This has been child rearing advice with analysis roulette.
You're welcome, parents. I'm so sorry for how much I swore during this. You know, whenever you look up any podcast, the biggest complaint in the reviews is always that they swear too much. I can't stop myself. Okay, that was Hawk's Diversion Corner.
That was Hawk's Diversion Corner.
It was important to me that you knew that.
I mean, sounds great.
He is great. He's another fan favorite. Dabby Hawks is one of the most popular ships in terms of content, as far as I can tell. I did not run numbers on this because life's too short. But it's one of the ones you hear about a lot. And you totally understand why. Like, come on, man.
These are matching tragedies.
They are matching tragedies. And, like, it ends badly, which we love.
That
love
is the
things
best thing
that end
ship.
Badly.
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, look, man, I do not ship Professor X and Magneto because I want them to have a happy ending, you know?
No.
I want things to burn, and Dabby will burn things for me.
That's like his superpower.
It's his whole deal. So yeah, I've like rattled us through just some of the plot points that I think are relevant to my idea that this is a very, very postmodern story. I don't think, obviously, these are randomly selected. But, like, this is one that I think really works because it's a story about stories in that, not when you say something is a story about stories, normally you mean it's like a very self-aware story, maybe has a narrator. No, this is a story set in a universe where people looked at Spider-Man and Superman and X-Men and went, yeah, that's what we should base society on.
Right. They literally said, we have been forced to have a revolution. Basically, like in terms of societal upheaval, a revolution is happening to us. We get to decide where to steer it. We are steering it at Spider-Man.
Yeah, and I like there's an old Anime News Network interview with the author of My Hero Academia, Kohei Horikoshi, and he does actually talk about what his main inspirations were. And he does, obviously, there are other anime and manga that are cited. So, like, Naruto is the main one he cites as an influence on art style. But he's also in various places mentioned Kamen Rider and Dragon Ball and a couple of others. Like, very shonen anime that you can see going into the DNA of this. But the things he mentions as American influences are Spider-Man, Star Wars, and X-Men. Those are the three I've seen the most often.
Mm-hmm.
So I think we can safely assume that when this society was rebuilt... Based on comic books. Yeah, those were the source texts of this universe. Which means this is a universe with identifiable source texts from our universe, which I think is the most postmodern thing I've ever encountered.
Right. I just need a moment to enjoy that is a thing we can say about really any setting. Like, just I need a moment to bask in there being a setting that has been built additively from our universe plus, like, a conscious attempt to emulate fictional properties.
Ooh, isn't it fun?
It's good.
And it's like, it's not...
Me of, actually?
Yeah.
There is a subset of, like, fairly well-read nerd.
Mm.
Fairly well-read, like, lefty liberal type nerd.
Mm.
Who genuinely, like, their ultimate political project is to create Star Trek post-scarcity. Mm. Or...
Yes!
Ian Banks is the culture post-scarcity. Like, literally, yes. The kind of post-scarcity societies that they have seen in media.
Yes!
That's the political project.
There's actually...
But for X-Men.
This is extremely geeky of me, but I actually went to an exhibition at the Science Museum this year, which is about this exactly. I think it is. It's really good. It's specifically about like how ideas, not just designs and like machines, but also social and cultural ideas from science fiction have been imported into the real world.
Mm, this does sound really cool.
Really yes, good. I cannot really recommend it highly enough. Sorry to listeners, because this will presumably go out well after that exhibit has closed. But I recommend it highly. But like, this is the thing, it's like, there is a whole world of thought in the modern world that if we were like this story, whether that's an actual fictional narrative or a story we tell ourselves about what the past used to be like or whatever, the world would be better. We can just base it on this clear narrative thing.
Yes. Oh, it's the future looking version of the like statue avatar guys.
Yes.
Where society would be fixed if we just returned to doing marble sculptures.
Exactly. But this is the thing, right? Okay, so the two comic books that he cites a lot, Horikoshi that is, are Spider-Man and X-Men. And the thing is, I think you can see how this universe would be built using Spider-Man, X-Men, and like maybe Kamen Rider as exemplars. Like, uh-huh. The pro-hero system is kids who... In theory, as far as I can tell, kids who want to be heroes are kids who really want to do good in the world. They want to use their skills for good. They want to, with their power, be responsible. Laying it on with a trowel here.
A phrase you have never heard before because we just came up with it.
Are put into institutions where they learn at the hands of people who know how to use their powers. They study together, they train together, they apply for licensing in a professional capacity. It is set up like a career, but it's set up like the narrative arc of a superhero as well.
Yes.
But the thing that's interesting about Spider-Man and X-Men is their lives fucking suck.
Right. Like, the only reason you go to Professor X's School for Mutants is that you can't go to any other schools. And one of the reasons that you only go in those circumstances is that you are guaranteed to be, at absolute best, constantly picketed and harassed.
Yeah. Like,
probably involved in several apocalyptic scenarios before the end of your first week, but at best, constantly harassed over being a mutant.
Yeah, like, this is the thing. You and I have talked, just like, because these are the things we talk about before, about how Professor, the thing with X-Men is like, yes, it is awful to put children in the home base of a bunch of superheroes because they're at risk. But the reason they're there is the other way around. The superheroes are there to protect the children who are already at risk.
Right, yes. You're not putting the children in the superhero camp. You are building a superhero camp around the school where the vulnerable children are.
That's a much better phrase.
They will be vulnerable children if you don't. Only then you won't have superheroes in the way.
Yes. Like, the government is building robots to kill children. Professor X is not the problem.
Right. We have not, on this hill. We have not put the children near the danger.
Yeah.
We have put the defenders near the children.
Don't get me wrong. Like, I have said Magneto never did a thing wrong in his life on many occasions and meant it, but there is a school of, like, fan thought, which is like, oh well, Magneto's right, and if they just let Magneto destroy the government, then nothing would be bad, and really Professor X is the one who's making teenagers fight his battles, and you're just like,
this is bad reading, I would think.
Sorry, what do you think Professor X is doing here? Do you think he's just like bodily throwing children at robots? Like, do you think that's the situation?
Professor X actually invented the fastball special?
Like, they are throwing a grown adult man at robots who signed up for this. But yeah, like, this is the thing. Like, the X-Men's lives fucking suck. Spider-Man's life also sucks.
Yeah.
And very specifically, Spider-Man's life sucks, whether or not he has support from other superheroes. Like, when he, like, goes mask off in public, it's him that gets ramifications from that. When he tries to save the world, he usually loses a loved one. Like, his life is awful.
Right, and crucially, his life is awful because he feels that responsibility to do something.
Yeah.
And like, this is Spider-Man's life could be, like, fair to middling, given, you know, pre-existing issues of poverty and depression. If he just was like, well, I can stick to walls, but this doesn't seem urgent compared to just getting on with finishing high school.
Or if he'd just stuck with the WrestleMania gig.
Right. He could have made a whole range of choices where his superpower would be irrelevant to mildly positive.
Exactly.
Instead, he feels the responsibility to be a hero about it, and that directly makes his life suck.
Like, the thing with the X-Men, not all mutants are X-Men, and that isn't just because... Not all mutants. That isn't just because
right.
Only some of them have useful superpowers.
Not all mutants are split between Professor X and Magneto's philosophies. A lot of them are just, like, out there living their lives, being lightly mutated.
And it's not even the case that all powerful mutants are X-Men or Brotherhood. There are plenty of powerful mutants who are just, like, vibing. There are plenty of non-powerful mutants who are X-Men or Brotherhood and are putting their powers to cool uses.
And we love them the most because it's like, you have some feathers. That's your whole superpower, but you are working so hard with it.
And when they get days in the limelight, they are the greatest, greatest days. But, this
but
thing,
yes,
like,
it's a choice they've made to go and be a superhero about
it. Yeah. And this is the thing, is like, so you can kind of see from those the DNA of this society in Spider-Man, in X-Men. You can see how the DNA of this society is not, for example, in Superman.
No. Well, Superman is a standout individual. Part of the thing about being Superman is that no one else could be Superman.
And also, part of the thing about Superman is that he... I don't know how to phrase this without making it sound like a negative thing. He doesn't have this sort of burning need to do good that Spider-Man has. He doesn't have this sort of righteous need to do good that the X-Men have. It's a very... The only word coming to my brain is Midwest. Like, it's a very sort of... You know what I mean? It's like a very kind of calm, polite, no, I'm going to do good things because that's the right thing to do. I'm not saying he's never angry or righteous. Obviously. I just mean, like, the underlying drive of Superman feels very, like, well, no, obviously I'm going to do the right thing.
Mm.
That's just what, like, I do, because I'm a nice person. Do you know what I mean? Like, I get the impression that Superman's motivation for saving lives isn't on, like, a really deep fundamental level that different to Clark Kent's inclination to hold doors open for people.
Right. I feel like there's a combination of...
And that doesn't mean it's lesser or less, like, or that he has less willpower or something. I just mean, like, he chooses to be a good person because he wants to be.
Right, but in a way where he thinks of all his, even his most spectacular savings of the day, he also thinks of them as about equivalent to picking up the spider instead of squashing it and putting it outside.
Yeah. And, like, you see this with a lot of DC heroes.
Anyone would do this. This is just the decent thing to do. I'm not being a hero. I'm just doing the decent thing.
Yeah. And if you compare other DC heroes who've had, like, because, like, okay, apart from the Krypton thing, some of Clark Kent's charm is that he's just kind of had this really nice, easy life and chooses to be a good person. Like, there's no...
Yes,
there's
lack
no
of a tragic backstory. Right, the most tragic bit is, you know, he was orphaned and adopted, but he was orphaned and adopted as a tiny baby.
By
so
good people who love him.
Right, so his experience is just of having been raised by good people who love him. And that is nice.
Yeah.
But that, like, is helpful. It's still a compelling story. You don't need a tragedy to have a compelling story. It's a very
if anything, I think it's compelling for a different reason, which is there is a lot of people really don't like characters, and I'm not here to tell those people they're wrong, obviously. But, like, I do. I really love characters who are just nice. Like, I love it. Like, characters who just, like, want to be good and don't struggle with that, I think are good characters sometimes.
Right, not everyone has to be, like, tempted.
Yeah, I think it's a good narrative device when they are. I just think it's also a good narrative device when they're not. And this is a thing you see a lot with DC. One of the things I think DC very rarely does that Marvel does all the time is the heaping of misery upon characters. Not because DC characters have easier lives, but because their lives affect them in a different way narratively to what Marvel likes to do. Like, if you look at something like talked about Shazam,
ladles of tragedy, like pea soup.
Oh my god, everything that could go wrong. And like, we just looked at a couple of different origin stories and the movie. Like, there are versions where he's like horribly abused by his uncle, where his parents' entire inheritance is stolen. There are plenty of versions where he's a homeless street kid. There are also versions where he's a clueless rich kid. Backstories change a lot in DC.
There is a common thread of, we have just heaped the misery upon this kid.
Yeah. And one of the things that I really like about Captain Marvel / Shazam as a character is that one of his most common catchphrases has been, do good and good will follow. And I've always really liked how simple it is, because I think it sums up to me what I like about that kind of character, which is that to them it really is that simple.
Yeah.
But this is what I like about Superman and Captain Marvel / Shazam and Wonder Woman, and to an extent Batman. Like, Batman is the gritty, dark DC character, but at the same time, like, he's someone who has this very iron core of, I'm choosing to be a good person, I want to be a good person, I know if I cross these lines I won't be able to come back, so I am not crossing them. Like, there is a simplicity to the superheroism of the sort of main DC characters that I find really appealing.
Yeah, however, he's sort of
Sorry, go.
I was just going to say that he's sort of often treated as the sort of the morally grey one, but he does actually have a very rigid code that is more restrictive even than he necessarily thinks is morally necessary, because he is sort of building himself a guardrail against possible slippery slopes.
And it's like, it's also why I have so little time for people who like are anti Batman's no kill rule. It just seems incredibly juvenile to me.
And especially when you consider that he is an American superhero, it is so easy to sort of understand Batman's no killing thing, not as a, because there should never be a death penalty, because, you know, in the American context, that's a more radical statement than in ours, but as a, I do not extrajudicially kill people.
Like, I'm sorry, do you want random billionaires who cage fight to think they have the right to kill people? Because, like, that's how you get shot in the head by Mark Zuckerberg.
Right, it's a personal rule against me doing extrajudicial vigilante killings, which is a different thing to a universal moral rule that no one should ever die.
Yes.
And I think that nuance tends to drop out of discourse.
I know, and it's also like, just sort of, even if it was a rule that no one should ever die, I think that's an okay rule for people to have.
Right, I am not, to be clear, opposed to the let's not kill people rule. Society may have grown beyond the need for the death penalty, but
this is the thing. It's much more complicated than he personally is just not willing to kill people. But also, even if it was that simple, I'm okay with that.
Right, I would not object to him having a not doing murders because murder's bad.
Anyway,
not believing in a difference between, like, executions and murders.
Anyway, we have gotten very far off track with this.
We're so off track, I may be cutting the whole provoke everyone in the on the internet with death penalty discourse section. Yes.
Yeah, maybe. Might be a good idea. We'll see. It depends how much of me umming and ahhing you cut earlier and how we're doing for time.
But I need to leave in the death penalty discourse for time.
Well, now you're going to have to leave it in because that was funny. Anyway, my point being, you can see how the DNA of superheroes in this universe is built on Spider-Man and X-Men and not on Superman and Wonder Woman.
Sure.
And
which is to say it's coming from Marvel rather than DC.
Yeah, but it's also like, it's also not Daredevil. You know what I mean?
That's fair, yeah.
Like, Spider-Man and X-Men,
quite specific properties that the people of the universe have picked to build their society upon.
Yeah. And this is the thing. The anime opens with, and I think it's not actually the opening of the manga, but it's very close, a reference to the phrase, not all men are created equal. And I learned this very young because I was quirkless and everyone else had a quirk.
Mm-hmm.
We're rolling back to wearing your themes on your sleeve. We are opening with, the world is not fair. And very specifically, the world is not fair, and this is about America.
Yes. Yes.
Exclusively.
The world, which is not fair, is America. And it is not fair in these following ways.
The world, which is not fair, has based itself upon the central mythos of American existence.
Yeah. Which is an interesting set of choices to make when you find yourself in societal upheaval.
And this is not a universe that remade itself based on Superman. It's also not a universe that remade itself based on Naruto or Dragon Ball. It's a universe that remade itself based on Spider-Man and X-Men, which are both the results of a couple of guys. Like, they have very overlapping early creative teams. Both of them were created, well, basically by a bunch of Jewish American comic book artists who wanted there to be more relatable superheroes.
Yeah.
They come from very similar sources. And like I said with the Star Wars stuff, My Hero Academia is littered with references to Western canon, inverted commas, because this is Western canon expanded to include comic books. The main character's superpower and nemesis are called All for One and One for All. The
Which
places
is not
are
subtle.
Named after Star Wars places. We open with American Independence.jpg.
Right. But specifically, the myth of American independence.
This is a universe based on American culture. And I think this is me making a political point, maybe a little bit, sorry. But that's not relevant to the world we live in today. The way that societies across the globe are shaped around American narratives and myths.
Right. I mean, you can't... Because of where Hollywood is and the status that English has as sort of the global lingua franca, which is itself a result of colonialism, but that's not the point. Between those two things, everyone is aware of American culture. Everyone gets American blockbusters. Everyone is able to watch them, pretty much. And they get translated into every language because Hollywood publishes everywhere.
Mm.
You can't not notice the MCU.
Yeah, and this is the thing, is like, Horikoshi has talked about the themes he focuses on. Like, it's not like he's never discussed this topic, and he said a lot, like, he's interested in what makes heroes, and talked about his emphasis on that being in, like, friendship, determination, the idea that anyone can be a hero through having these virtues. And I do think that is a theme that is explored extensively, but it's a theme that's explored extensively through narrative and not through world building. And the themes the world building set up are the flaws that are slipping through the cracks of a society built upon a myth and a story.
Yeah. It's all of the points where human behavior does not match the broad strokes superhero myth.
If Endeavor wants to have this story where his power conquers the above power, he can't determination and hard work and friendship his way through that. He has to do awful things to achieve his goal. And he does, and he does. Shinzo is a character who exists in a world that is built upon a narrative where people like him are monsters.
Right, and everything in his life is based on either being that or reacting against that.
Yeah, there's no opt-out. He can't just not be the bad guy character archetype, because he is. That's the character that he is.
Yeah, he can sort of very consciously and deliberately and with advertising, almost, you know, he can subvert his archetype, but he will always be subverting his archetype and not just being a greengrocer.
Yeah, and this is why I'm going to loop us back to the first couple of episodes, the ones you have seen. One of the very first things we see from Katsuki, who, it's been a while since I mentioned him, you do remember him blowing up stuff with his hands and his sweat.
I empathize
with deeply on this horrendously hot day. We would be in trouble if my sweat was explosive.
Honestly, I will not be that surprised, because it is that hot.
It's so hot. One of the very first things we learn about this kid. Okay, so we see him being kind of a bully in childhood, and then we cut to present day. He's in middle school. He's applying to become a hero. He finds out that the kid with no superpowers is becoming a hero. And he blows up his belongings. He out and out suicide baits him. And specifically what he says is, I'm going to be a great hero. And great heroes have to have great backstories. And I've decided that my backstory is that I was the first person from this shitty middle school to go to the best hero school in the country.
And therefore you can't come.
And therefore you cannot
ruin
have
my story.
You cannot have what you want, to the extent that I will assault and threaten you and encourage you to kill yourself.
My backstory can encompass me basically murdering you, but cannot encompass being one of two first people to go to the cool school.
Yeah, because you can't have two superheroes with the same backstory. I mean, even the X-Men eventually got different backstories.
Okay, but double act. I'm just saying, be a double act. You can't have a double act that has the same backstory. Okay,
but like, one of them, that's the thing, is the childhood clearly shows they were supposed to be a double act, but one of them didn't get a quirk.
Right, and then that throws
and
the
rules of the universe say, well, now I have to be a superhero on my own, and I have to have backstory I've planned for myself, otherwise I can't have the narrative I've planned for myself, because we live in a universe based on narratives.
Right.
This is the thing It's the thing with the Endeavor family, the Todoroki family, it's the thing with Bakugo, it's even the thing with Hawks. They didn't see a kid and go, hey, that's marketable. They saw the kid and went, hey, that's fitting within the narrative that we have for superheroes, that we have based our universe around.
Right, not we can market this as a superhero, but we recognize this as a superhero based on the rules that we've internalized of what a hero is.
Exactly. And this is the thing with Stain, is he's killing off superheroes he perceives as unworthy.
Based on mysterious internal rubrics.
But the idea, it's a job. This is the thing, is it's treated like a narrative, but it's a
job. They're
not
freelancers. Like, I mean, I guess they're freelancers, but they're not Spider-Man doing this in secret.
Yeah. It's
there's
like
an official public ranking of superheroes. There's a school. There's a license.
Why are you being a serial killer about it? Start a blog. Like, that came from deep within. I'm sorry.
That was heartfelt.
This is like the guy who says that like Yakuza aren't respected anymore because there are quirks and therefore there are superheroes and therefore everyone cares about superheroes and villainy. These are all people who have bought into the idea that the universe is constructed on narrative. Because it is.
Right, which is in turn because it is a piece of fiction and it almost knows that.
And that is, I'm saying a third time, that is the most postmodern thing I have ever heard in my life. I'm just going to say that whole sentence again. I've said it before, I'm saying it again, that is the most postmodern thing I've ever heard in my life.
I buy it, yeah, okay, I'm sold. You know, you've convinced me.
Thank you. Maybe the paper notes was a good idea.
So in conclusion, what have we learned
from the Elder Scrolls?
we've learned that postmodernism real, and watch My Hero Academia to learn why.
Yes, and we've also learned that there are a lot of contenders for the role of defining postmodern text. I would nominate My Hero Academia as the one that should replace them on all university courses.
I support this, if only because I'm a troll.
Yes. I also think you should go and not necessarily watch, maybe read some like summaries of My Hero Academia so I can send you some fanfiction links, because, oh my god, some of these pairings are so good. This is the problem with a world constructed on narrative, is it gives you opportunities.
Some of the narratives really have the juice.
You know when there's a narrative and it's like writing-y?
It does please me when that happens.
It's so writing-y.
Should we roll some dice?
Let's roll some dice.
Find out.
Hang on, have I taken out postmodern? No, sorry. You are going to need to roll a 17-sided die, a thing that's normal to own.
Fortunately, I have the internet. I have rolled a 2.
Ooh, psychoanalytic.
Oh, let's get Freudian.
Actually, Freudian is a separate thing. This is non-Freudian psychoanalytic.
I'm not sure how clearly we delineated these.
So I think we decided to divide psychoanalysis into specifically Jungian, specifically Freudian, meaning the you know, that kind of Freudian, and then psychoanalytic meaning the rest of it. This is Freudian without the sex.
Right. This is not we're doing formalized therapeutic psychology, but not the Oedipus stuff.
Yeah, the Oedipus stuff has its own category because we thought we'd like to try both of them on for size.
I think we were probably right on that. How many works do we have?
Before we do that, we need to decide whether or not My Hero Academia is going back in the bag.
I feel like you have more to say about My Hero Academia, and I am willing for more to be said.
I definitely have more to say. I skipped so much stuff.
Yeah, put it back in. Why not?
There are whole like arcs and entire characters I didn't throw in. Okay, cool. So let's have a 101-sided die, please.
101. Ooh, an interestingly high number. 85.
80. Light Lark.
So I know very little about this. We had a conversation or two about this, But from what we discussed, I think this is going to be a fascinating experience.
Oh God, we both have to read it now.
That is the downside of this experience that we're going to have, but I don't know, maybe I'm speaking too soon. Maybe I'm going to fall in love with this.
Oh God.
We are doing psychoanalysis of a TikTok favorite, and how can this possibly go wrong?
Well, thank you for listening. I hope you learned something about postmodernism. I really hope you learned something about My Hero Academia. And come back next time to find out whether or not we accidentally fell in love with TikTok's most hated book.
See ya.
Bye.
You've been listening to Analysis Roulette, a podcast applying a randomly selected mode of analysis to a randomly selected creative work, just to see what happens. Your hosts have been Dia and Duck. You can find us on Spotify or on YouTube. And if you'd like to get in touch, you can send us an email at analysisroulette@gmail.com. And remember, if you like our show, share it with your friends. And if you don't like our show, share it with your enemies.